Hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and whatever else is watching. My name is Nick, and I just wanted to talk about the Game Awards that happened last Thursday to Friday night. Well, I live in the Netherlands, so it started at 2:30 in the morning with the pre-show. 2:30 at night, because most people are still sleeping at that time, and ended around 6 o'clock in the morning. That's when most people are actually getting out of bed. Yes, I stayed up, however, I did came prepared by sleeping at least a few hours beforehand, so I would be able to stay awake throughout the night, because, really, that's late, man. That's really, really late. And I know it's been said a little bit to American time zone that it is appropriate time to be viewed for American audiences, while the rest of the world either had to watch really late at night or early in the morning. Although I think Japan had a good one as well, if you took the day off, because then you would have to watch it during the day, because I think it was in the evenings for the American audiences. However, what are the Game Awards for those who don't know it yet? Actually, they can be compared to the Oscars and the Grammys for movies and music. They are pretty much the biggest award show for the video game industry. And I think that is a really well accomplishment and a really well addition to the industry. You have a lot of more events, and there are also some other game shows such as the Golden Joystick Awards, but none are really that as big, and other events are mostly E3. GDC, Game Developers Conference. You also have the Tokyo Game Show, and then actually more presentations where the industry just puts out news about upcoming games and how they do things, or just discussing general things in the industry. And well, it does provide a lot of announcements. However, and it has also its own awards with it for mostly what was shown at the shows themselves. So not really about what actually came out that year. It was more, limited to the show. And that's why I think the Game Awards, being how big they have become and how well they have improved in the last 5 years, is such a good addition to the industry. It recognizes all the games that have been put out in the past couple of years. Well, not completely a year, because I'm still figuring out what the cutoff date and the starting date is for video game awards. I know that halfway November is the cutoff date for the game awards, because the show is at the beginning of December, and they have to present the nominees, have the voting and all that kind of stuff, because it's voted based on industry's professionals and actually just the general public itself, which is a good trade-off, although sometimes you wonder whether some games got awards just because they are played by a lot of people, and instead of actually deserving it through quality, or that they are actually the best of the nominees. But then again, that's also, again, personal preference. You don't want everything to be by industry specialist, because then you would say, okay, those games are bought. However, if you put everything in the hands of just voting by the general public, then you get a really which game is just a popular vote kind of deal, which can make the biggest commotion of, hey, vote for me stuff. So yeah, that's why I think it's really good that the system that they have come up with. It's not the best, but it's the best trade-off. It's the best compromise, I think, what they have at this moment. So, yeah, it's really well. And the Game Awards, they grow every year. And it's pretty much 3 hours long, in a sense. Because it started at 3 and ended at 6 or something. And they present a lot of categories and they recognize a lot of things. They have even an award for industry icon. Each year they give a person a award for their, well, deeds. They recognize that person for what they have done for the game industry their entire career. And that's not just the last year. It's more or less since, well, the beginning of the game industry. Well, for the most of them, it's just around the 80s, because that's where it actually took off. But hey, there are also a lot of games made before the 80s, before the NES came on board. You had the Atari 2600, and you had the ColecoVision in television. You had the Odysseys, a lot of stuff beforehand that also had deserved recognition. And that's really what the Game Awards is about. Presenting recognition and doing that in an entertaining manner. At the beginning of the Game Awards, there was a really nice bit that I thought really represents the industry. Actually, really represents more or less the console game industry, because you also have the PC game, but you don't really have a very representative for that one, because the PC game is more or less distributed over many, many companies. However, you had for the consoles, there was an opening bit that Sean Layden from Sony, Phil Spencer from Microsoft, and Reggie Fils-Aimé from Nintendo came up together to talk to the audience, to present them. Okay, I have to say they read off a cue card. That was visible for everyone in that that had to do a presentation, because you just saw them staring at a point somewhere in space. So you pretty much knew that they were reading up whatever it was. Those who did a forced presentation, not the victors. Those actually were honest in their thank you words and everything, but the ones that did the presentation there, you could see that they were. However, with those three, it was just with Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo coming up together. It just shows how much the industry has grown. Before this, it was always the console wars. The console wars. Which game console is better? Which game console outperforms the other? Which one do you need to buy? Which one don't you need to buy, and which one is ultimately trash, and if you're on team this, team that, team PlayStation, team Xbox, or team Nintendo, and it's just, or even earlier, team Sega was even there. And actually this just showed that, no, the console wars don't need to be a war. Yes, all the companies are competing for a limited amount of market share, because not everyone has in infinite amount of money to spend on everything. Yes, they are competing, but you also, they are working together. They are building off of one another, making themselves better, because they try to bring what is in their vision the best quality in game entertainment that they think is possible for the industry, and that they can bring. And that's what I really like about this. It's not just one system that is better. No, it is about, we have a game industry that thrives on competition and cooperation. They work together, even though they are also competing. And that is what I really liked about that opening bit. Overall, the presentation is something that I really liked. They set it well up. The Game Awards have become really great with, well, the award announcements musical performances, and also new announcements of games that are to be released or that are currently in development. And with that, they really made a good presentation for it. On the awards, well, it's pretty much... it was really interesting to see that God of War won the best game of the year, especially considering that another nominee in that category, Red Dead Redemption 2, was pretty much scooping up all the other awards that they were nominated both for. Yeah, it was really... I thought at the beginning, okay, considering how many awards Red Dead Redemption 2 is picking up, they are picking also up God of War, of the best game of the year. However, it turned out God of War was it. And I have to say, it's a good choice. Although, personally, I would have preferred Celeste. However, that is more driven by the... How do I say it? By the idea that it would present a message to some of the publishers, some of the game developers, that you don't have to put in a lot of money. You don't have to put in with the biggest graphical stuff and the biggest graphical where you have thousands of people working on it, night and day, crunch hours to meet deadlines and everything, just to put out a AAA title where it's already known beforehand that no amount of copies sold will ever make it go break even. Where the companies already say after the first weekend that the game is out, that it is already a financial bomb. And that is why I thought, well, maybe it would be good if Celeste won. However, making Celeste already a nominee is a really big accomplishment. And that also tells companies already, hey, here's a small game. Not graphically impressive. It's pretty much 8-bit sprite graphics. And it doesn't have the budget of a AAA title, and yet it is competing with the rest of them. So, yeah, I think that's a good thing. However, God of War, congratulations, dudes, and Santa Monica. You pretty much delivered a good game, and you got a prize that deserved it. So, but then again, there are other award categories, which I think are good additions to the Game Awards. For example, Narrative is a good one. Games for Impact. Games don't really need to have to be just to sell copies. But Games for Impact is really good. Indie Games is recognizing smaller companies that would otherwise be overrun by AAA title publishers, big publishers. Game for Audio Design, which I will come back later when I go discuss the stage performances and everything. Also, they have a content creator, YouTubers, Twitch streamers, and all that a category for them. And I think those are really good categories that present a diversity in the game industry. What makes up a good game? And what makes up, well, not in the sense of content creators then, but what makes up a good game industry and an entertainment industry. And that is what I think, yeah, is really well done. There are also a number of categories that I'm wondering about. What were they thinking with that? And no, I'm not talking about mobile game, because even mobile games are games. No, I am more thinking about... They had a category for best sport / racing. I know that sports and racing games usually have annual installments. Well, not racing games, but sports games do. They have annual installments that, well, would be nominees every single freaking year, because you would see every single freaking year, you would see a FIFA or an NBA or Madden or something, and probably turning up on those on the nominees list. And I don't know what it was with racing, but only Forza Horizon 4 was on there, and I'm wondering whether were there even more race games released the last year? Wasn't Gran Turismo also didn't have a release last year or something? Or was that in that Dead Zone cutoff date where they start counting the games and where they don't have to cut off? Well, it's more or less the December, January months, I think, where you get games. But I'm not too sure about whether there are any more racing games. Because that's what's really weird about it. Why was sports and racing games so clumped together? Of course, you also have the things, and well, categories that, okay, it's good for the industry, esports. Esports, and that esports are getting bigger, but there are also a more than half dozen categories just dedicated to esports. I think, well, okay, best esports player or best esports team or something and game can be good. Event also, okay. But actually, best esports player, that when he came to the stage, that dude was just awesome. You could just see how excited he was and how unprepared he actually thought he was going to win. He thought, okay, I'm going to show up for the show because, hey, I'm one of the nominees. But probably they are not even announcing it on the stage, and they are probably not even having him getting up, or that he probably would not be the winner. However, when he heard that he was the winner and had to come up on stage just to get the award, well, that was just so awesome to see that. Just his spontaneity and, well, how do we put this? Just his vibes and everything, his enthusiasm, his just also his anxiety that was just so clearly visible, and just made a good presentation all over. However, there's one category in there that I'm thinking about. What the fuck is that in there? Best esports moment. Okay, I know you can have moments in esports that have a impact on things, but does that really need to have an award? Or was that just a award to fill out, how do I say it, the rapid fire esports announcements? Because some of these categories, also esports and other categories, we just announced rapid fire without actually anyone coming up to the stage to get an award or something. That's just Jeff Keighley was just standing somewhere off to the side, looking into the camera and saying, okay, these and these people in this category, he won. This category, that dude won. This category, that studio or game won. And that were just a little bit of rapid fire things. Also needs to be there, but because you have a lot of categories to go over each year, but it's still, well, it's something. I was wondering about why is the best esports moment in there. I can understand player and team or something, and even game, but esports moment? Really? Really? Why? However, enough spoken about the awards itself. There was also the award show was bigger than that, because they are also a entertainment event. Because it's not just about handing out an award and going down a list or anything. What the Game Awards added to it, and it's also something you see with the Grammys and with Oscars is that there are also stage performances. Just to present some entertainment to in some switch up for the audience in the room or in the Microsoft Theater in this case, and the audience at home, that you wouldn't fall asleep or something because you're just going down the list and list and list. No, there were actual stage performances in bits of music where they had a orchestra performing game music. Some of these bits were a little bit awkward, and I was thinking about what also others said about it, is that, well, did it fit what you would think of the game it would represent? But on the other side, it was entertaining. I enjoyed what they brought there. I enjoyed what they had going on with that. And I really think that is a good addition to it, to what, well, the Game Awards are. It also celebrates a very underappreciated aspect of video games. And that's the music, the audio design. Because nowadays, games are pretty much, okay, I need to have a good marketing picture. So it has to look good. It has to pop. It has to attract the attention of the eye. So who cares about what the rest of the game is? As long as it's looking good, it will sell. Making the best graphics, even if it doesn't run properly, just as long as we can sell it to, well, whatever. And that's just an overemphasizing on how much graphical power anyone can put out nowadays. Really, it's just about the resolution and graphical powerhouses when you go for systems nowadays, that it is really undervaluing what the rest actually is, gameplay and also audio, music. Because you can have a average or maybe even a bad looking game, but if you have really good music with it, it can even outdo or become a better game than a game that has really much graphical splendor, but a just average music score that no one remembers. Music sets the mood, and that is why I really like that they actually added those musical sections that celebrate audio in the in games and all of that. And that's really what I liked about it. But of course, this is also a game event. And like with all other game events, such as the E3 and Gamescom and game developer conferences, it cannot go by without having its own set of announcements. New game announcements, new information about games that were already announced. Some surprise hits, some were already rumored to be leaked way ahead of time. Most announcements, though, were multi-platform game announcements, which mostly are also for the Epic Game Store, which is a new PC game store which tries to compete with Steam or something. And most of them were also multi-platform games. However, I think Nintendo stood out in the game announcement section because I saw a lot of openings with Nintendo Switch click before each trailer. Because Nintendo also had several exclusive announcements to the Nintendo Switch. One of the biggest and one of the most, how do I say this, surprising to me, was Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3. Man, I really liked the X-Men Legend games and the Marvel Ultimate Alliance games earlier, and I thought, well, they were probably done with those line of games. So seeing Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3 and exclusive for the Switch was really nice to see. Although I don't think exclusive for the Switch is not going to be for long. Probably in a year or two. It will also go to probably the Xbox and the PlayStation. And that is just a timed exclusivity. However, if Nintendo pulled something that they also did with the, how do I say it, with Bayonetta, where they actually pushed for most of the funding, then it probably is, well, it could be that this will be an exclusive to the Switch. But that depends on how much involved Nintendo was with creating this game. Otherwise, you will see it going to the other systems as well. But that also made Nintendo pretty much the biggest presence in when it comes to announcing. Because Sony and Microsoft didn't have actually exclusive games to their system announced here. Sony actually was barely there. Even though you wouldn't consider that. Sony and Microsoft were only there through the multi-platform titles. And even then, there were a couple of multi-platform titles, such as Mortal Kombat, that also goes to the Switch. But however, you will probably see the best versions on the Xbox and on the PlayStation 4 and everything. So, yeah. Probably people don't even think multi-platforms matter for the Switch, but they do. Even matter for the PlayStation, even matter for the Xbox, they all matter. And, well, that also made it that, well, the announcements for the Xbox and Sony were pretty much few and far between, actually. Nothing serious from Sony and Microsoft themselves. Although there are also a couple of people I've heard online that were really disappointed that Nintendo had no presence during this Video Game Awards, because they were actually hoping on, well, how do I say this, on a few, announcements of games that they were really hoping forward to get trailers for, because they were leaked apparently. They were leaked that there was a Metroid Prime 4 or Metroid Prime Trilogy trailer being announced at this at the Game Awards. However, they didn't appear. And that is made some people really angry and really disappointed, while they were so hyped up by rumors that were probably put out by either disgruntled employees or someone playing a prank. Yeah, you got hyped up over rumors. That's why I usually don't consider rumors at all. Because, in all honesty, why? Rumors are just that, rumors. And they are even more likely to change, more likely to, well, be different than when they are actual announcements. Usually I go for things getting hyped when the respective company actually announces it themselves. Because even a minute before they announce it, they can pull that announcement, a company. Because if they think it's not ready or not, or so, then yeah, it's just that. They think it's just not ready. And then being mad that the rumors didn't come true and putting all that blame on those respective companies because you got hyped up for nothing. That's just your own problem, dude. Or do that, whatever it is. However, well, I have to say, there were good announcements. That were really good announcements. Like I said, Sony and Microsoft presence in announcement department was very little all throughout the, well, how do you say it? Well, multi-platform titles. However, it did seem that Sony and Microsoft had a bigger presence in this award show. But that mostly comes because they had games that were actually in the awards categories. Nintendo had barely anything. And even in those games where they in categories where they had something in it, like sports and family game, they didn't even won anything in there. So, and Sony was there with games such as God of War, Spider-Man, which had many nominees. And then you have things like Monster Hunter and Red Dead Redemption that are pretty much on the PlayStation and Xbox and not on the Switch, which makes it seem as if those two companies had a bigger presence. Well, that was it. Overall, I think the video game awards were really entertaining. And those who got their awards were really deserving of those awards. They really deserve because of the quality that they put out. Although you might be considering, hey, who determined those awards? But all in all, we had a good game award show. And I have to say, I'm looking forward to the next award show in 2019. However, I am going to look up what those cutoff days are. Because, frankly, I would have thought Xenoblade Chronicles would have entered at least in the list of 37 pre-nominees for Best RPG. But what I heard, they weren't. And that was because they were released in December? Could that mean that Super Smash Bros. Brothers Ultimate is also not gonna be a nominee in the next year? Yeah, that's something that I'm still have to look up what is what. Because that's the only thing that I'm really uncertain about. And that is what they are really unclear about. Well, they are clear about when they cut it off. They are just not clear about when they start counting for that year. And that is what is something I think they should be making clear. So, all in all, a good show. Can't wait for the next year. But I hope you enjoyed this video, which was, still pretty long. I still talked a lot about it. I thank you for watching. I thank you for listening. I'm wondering what you thought about the Video Games Awards. What you think about the nominees and the winners and everything. And also what categories there were. Leave those thoughts in the comments below. And I like to read them. Until then, until the next video, I'll see you back then. Goodbye and thank you for watching.